I had just turned 7. I didn't know what it was to mean. But for 8 years, I endured it as a child and a teen.
My father started to hit and touch me. But this was just the start.
He groomed me and prepared me for the group.
I had to participate in some awful things and deal with the nightmares that today it brings.
Electrocution and drowning were some of their tools for when I was bad and broke their rules.
It didn't stop there. They used snakes and wasps or left me out in the dark to die in the frost. Well, he obviously didn't die, did he? Because he's alive and still in fucking prison, for fuck's sake.
In 2014, Carl Beech, a seemingly unremarkable man from Gloucester, perhaps better known by his pseudonym Nick, claimed he'd been the victim of a VIP paedophile ring in the 1970s and 80s.
I wish it never happened. Life would have been very different if it had never happened. These appalling allegations and all the aftermath of that and the press and the, you know, maybe the staring in the street, who knows. But all of that, I mean, you have to have an enormous sense of inner reserves just to get you through it.
It was humiliating. It was affront to him. Everything he stood for, you know, duty, service to his nation. You know, it was sort of incomprehensible, really.
So who was Carl Beech? And why did he choose to go public with this extraordinary story?
I think to understand what happened with Carl Beech, we have to step back a few years. Late in 2011, Jimmy Savile died, and a number of people undoubtedly knew what Savile was up to. The rumour had been spreading, but it was suppressed.
We knew that Jimmy Savile had been a prolific child abuser. That changed the nature of the way that the UK was dealing with child sexual abuse as an issue.
The pendulum went from the disbelief of Jimmy Savile through to the opposite spectrum, that actually now all these cases were coming out of the woodwork, if you like, and needed to be believed. And into this mix came Carl Beech.
They knew where I was. They knew where I went to school. I don't know, they knew everything. I don't know how.
In 2012, Beech told Wiltshire police he'd been sexually abused by his stepfather, by Jimmy Savile, and by some other men he called the group.
Okay, so how would you end up being at these places with the group?
I was taken there, sometimes from school. During the night, I'd be taken out of school.
When you say taken out of school, I mean, were you in a playground and dragged out, or were we talking something different? Like, how were you taken out?
No. School.
After a brief investigation, Wiltshire police dismissed Beech's allegations, but not before Beech had submitted a compensation claim for the abuse he had suffered. 2 years later, he began writing about his abuse online.
I first came across the person that I later identified as Carl Beech through a blog on a website. And on that website, there was a guest blogger who had blogged under the name Carl. I met him in central London in Selfridges. He came across as very nervous, very vulnerable. He's a bright guy. He's very clever and he's very articulate.
Beech named 12 men who he said had abused and raped him. The list included Beech's stepfather, an army major, as well as more high-ranking members of the military, including Field Marshal Lord Bramall.
I was just shown into an office and the senior officer was there, General Bramall. My father saluted and introduced me. He didn't challenge them. You know, that fear was ingrained from day one.
Also on the list were politicians and other members of the establishment. Some of them had already been accused of sexual offences. Others had unproven rumours about their sexual proclivities circulating on the internet. One of these was Lord Britton.
He was sadistic. He took pleasure in hurting or seeing us in pain.
Another was Sir Edward Heath.
He told me he used to run the country.
Right, right.
Whether he actually said that he was Prime Minister, I don't know, but he used to run the country. And again, that didn't really mean much.
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't to an 11-year-old, yeah? I can understand that.
Beech even alluded to a possible murder.
Without question, they were the most serious allegations I'd ever heard. Certainly, in terms of the magnitude of the allegations, they were mind-blowing.
That first occasion, I was 7. It was mainly military bases for probably a good few years. And the only one I know for sure now is Imber, which is in Salisbury Plain. It's just like a village, but a ghost village, nothing there.
I remember thinking, blimey, this could make or break you. But I'd said to him, obviously I'm a journalist, in order for us to cover this, if we're going to go anywhere with this, we need to find other witnesses, we need to corroborate the information. I took him to various locations in the early days, just to see whether or not he recognised them. I remember taking him to an area that Ted Heath had lived in. So I walked him down this road just to see if he picked out the property. And to my surprise, he stopped outside the former home of Ted Heath. He didn't identify the actual house, but he stood on that part of the road and he looked around and he said, "This is very familiar to me. I'm familiar with this arrangement."
Although Beech couldn't provide any hard evidence, For Conrad, this was an irresistible story with the potential to make his career. He arranged an interview with Beech on the investigative news website, Exaro.
A common one was for us or me to give them oral sex. But it would always culminate in being raped.
It was a scoop. And you know, I know that we got contacted by a lot of the UK's media after that, who wanted access to Beech, who wanted footage from the website. We were getting, you know, phone calls left, right and centre from not just the tabloids, but the broadsheets too.
Did you ever go to his house?
I went to his house on a couple of occasions. He lived in an unspectacular suburban home on the outskirts of Gloucester with his son. And, you know, obviously he'd explained to me that he was separated or divorced from his wife and that, you know, he lived alone with his son.
Beech and his wife had first met when they were both training as nurses in the NHS. But in 2010, after 18 years of marriage, they split up.
He was friendly, he was nice, and in a way, he could almost show me a life that was a little bit more privileged.
Were you happy in the marriage?
That's an interesting question. I was happy, but then I was also unhappy. Oh, God.
It's all right, darling. What were the things in the marriage that weren't good for you?
One of the issues was the intimate side of the marriage. It just wasn't very good at all.
Had it ever been good?
Not really, no.
Did he ever tell you that he'd been sexually abused as a child?
Yes. But he said to me, I've got a letter that I've written to my mum and I want you to read it. This was a letter that he wrote to his mum to say that he had been sexually abused by his stepfather, Ray Beech. And when I read it, I just remember looking at Carl and just saying, oh my God. And I think I hugged him, because what else can you do?
In the first instance, he said the reason why he went and sought help through a counsellor was really through relationship counselling, and that what emerged from the discussions then was the background of child sexual abuse and how that had impacted upon him subconsciously down the years.
I met a few counsellors before I settled on one that I felt comfortable with, and this was so important. I would not have said I trusted them at that stage, but I felt comfortable with them, and they helped me to share what happened to me little by little. As I told her more and more over time, she said it was like looking at me through a forest. Gradually, as she gets closer, she can see more of me. She was cutting through my past to get to me.
As part of his therapy, Beech's counsellor asked him to chart and describe the injuries he'd sustained in the course of his abuse.
Green, broken bones. Yellow, I was hit everywhere, face, side and back of head. red burn. The red on the soles of my feet was from a lighter. Blue needles and pins were stabbed into me, mainly on the soles of my feet, in between my fingers and on my chest. Purple snake bites, black wasp stings.
I never thought I would be in a position to thwart any of them. And then that all changed when the Metropolitan Police contacted me via Megzaro.
To my surprise at that stage, Beech said, yes, I'll talk to the police. And that was the U-turn, that was the change of heart.
Encouraged to go to the Met by Labour MP Tom Watson, Beech now claimed to have witnessed three murders. An investigation called Operation Midland was launched. The BBC conducted interviews with Beech, lending the story weight by running it as the lead item on the news.
Police are investigating the possible murders of three boys in connection with an alleged historic paedophile ring involving powerful people. The group is alleged to have included senior figures in public life, the military, politics and law enforcement in the 1970s and 80s. Police are now appealing for witnesses to come forward.
I've never experienced pain like it. I hope I never do again. They had no fear at all of being caught. It didn't even cross their mind.
The first murder Beech had described to police was a hit-and-run incident he said he'd witnessed in Kingston.
I heard the car, the engine. And as I turned round to see what the noise was, it hit him. And it was thrown up into the air. And everything just stopped. Everything just stopped. There was a lot of blood. I had blood on my hands. And I was dragged away, but he died because I didn't do as I was told.
Beech also said he'd witnessed a second boy being fatally stabbed and a third boy being strangled to death by the group.
The murder of three young boys. To me, they were not just three boys. They meant everything. They were my friends. We shared a common bond, horrific as it was. We shared each other's fear and pain, and we knew what each other was thinking when no words were allowed. The trauma of watching them die, of holding them in my arms, of having their blood on my hands, and the total helplessness of not being able to stop it. I feel guilty every day that I survived and they didn't. The grief is overwhelming. I have had no closure. I didn't get to say goodbye.
Carl Beech was becoming Twitter famous. He had acolytes who followed him. He became not just a middle manager for an NHS trust, but he was suddenly courted by people on Twitter who wanted to know more about his story.
I joined Twitter and I saw what I felt was quite an amazing kind of concept.
Beech had given himself the Twitter handle Ravska, raising awareness for victims and survivors of child abuse, and was proposing an art exhibition inspired by the poppy installation he'd seen at the Tower of London.
It was and remained a very good idea that he came up with. He would get victims of child sex abuse to send in sort of images or pictures that were of emotional importance to them that would help them to tell us a broader story about child abuse. And it was, I think it was called The Wall of Silence, and it was all about breaking down the barriers of silence around child abuse in the UK.
Did you meet him in person, Mike?
I did. I thought he was fragile. He was anxious and, you know, kind of unsettled, if you like. And if I were asked if I felt that he'd experienced abuse trauma, I would have said yes.
Nick has been interviewed over a long period of time by experienced detectives from the Child Abuse Command. And he has also met investigator from the Murder Command. They and I believe what Nick to be saying is credible and true.
I was at the press conference. There were gasps within the room when it was said. I couldn't believe that the word true had been used.
Here he was, a white middle-class male, well-spoken, articulate, and a health professional in the NHS. He was a person of some substance. What reason would he have to say these things?
There's no doubt that in the early stages of this investigation, the police officers proceeded on the basis that everything they had been told, remarkable as it was, in my view, highly improbable from the very outset, they simply accepted the truth of everything that Nick had said to them.
It's been a secret for far too long. It's not just me, there are others. I'm trying to encourage somebody else to come forward, but I can't pressurise them. It has to be their own decision.
I need others to come forward and speak to us. You will be believed, you will be supported as we look to build this case.
At that time, Nick had talked about another victim called Fred, and he had told Operation Midland that he was in contact with Fred, and that Fred was ambivalent about coming forward. And obviously, the Midland officers, you know, very much wanted to talk to him. The police request for me to make contact with Fred, because Nick had provided his email address, came in February 2015.
Dear Fred, from what Nick has outlined to the police, it is clear that your childhood involved some horrific ordeals. Many people who have experienced sexual and other types of abuse just want to move on with their lives and put it behind them. This might particularly apply to this abuse perpetrated against Nick, you and others, given the people involved and the allegations of previous cover-up.
I don't trust people, per se. It takes a long time for me to establish trust, but I do have confidence in the police. They seem to be very dedicated in what they're doing and passionate about getting results.
Thank you.
8:30 in the morning, knock at the door, two police officers outside, and they said they had to search the house. I was sat in this room, in that chair, traumatised with shock and, you know, like a fly stuck to a flypaper. I couldn't move.
On the 4th of March 2015, the Met coordinated raids on the homes of three of the men Beech had named, searching for evidence of murder. As the police raided the Westminster home of former Home Secretary Lord Britton, who had only very recently died, in Yorkshire, officers also arrived to search the Britton's second home.
The doorbell went and it was about 8:30, and the police were outside with this warrant, and they came into the house and they said they were going to go right through the house, and they did, from top to bottom.
The stuff that was taken was shown to me, and all I remember saying is, I can't think why you're taking those videos, because, you know, these were videos of, Inspector Morse and things like that.
The boss was fanatical about saving things, saved bank stubs, photographs, Christmas cards. They bagged everything, dated it, and they started to bring it all downstairs. All these bags full of rubbish, really. The thing that hurt the lady more than anything, they took his slippers.
There's something about slippers which are different from shoes. You know, it's slippers and fires and pipes and all the rest of it.
Were they nice slippers?
They were a pretty awful pair of slippers, to be honest. No monogram.
At the same time, on the same day, the Met also searched the home of the former Tory MP Harvey Proctor and the home of Lord Bramall, former head of the British Armed Forces, who lived in Hampshire.
There was a knock on the door and two police officers stood at the door and he said, come in. He thought it was possibly a security issue.
I said, nice to see you. What can I do for you? And they said, there's an allegation being made about you.
Behind those two men came a sort of truckload of 20 other people, I think. And they went through the whole house.
They had special officers who dealt with paedophile cases, asking my daughter questions and so on. And my wife was seriously ill, but she was downstairs on a walker, and I had to move her from room to room, and she was kept on saying, what are they all doing here? And I, of course, couldn't really explain, because she had Alzheimer's.
I think they took a speech he made to cadets at Sandhurst, but there was nothing here at all.
The trouble was that once it was in the media made the most of it. They thought there must have been some presumption of guilt. So, of course, every time my name or my picture appeared in the paper, it was connected with wider sex scandal, or you had a picture and underneath it said, high-level cover-up, question mark. They always, by innuendo, tried to spread the idea that there must have been something in these allegations against me. You know, you're always worried about what might call the no smoke without fire brigade, you know.
Were those tactics heavy-handed?
Well, we've not confirmed what searches have taken place or have not, so I'm not going to comment on individual actions that we take. The point to make, from my perspective, is that we will go where the evidence takes us, without fear or favour. I think that's what the public expect, and it's certainly what our investigators are doing and are keen to continue to do.
They seem to be very careful that they're doing everything correctly. And it takes time to gather the evidence and, you know, if the evidence is there, then they need to make the arrests. And I would like to see justice.
As the investigation continued, Beech received his payout from his compensation claim and spent the money on a sports car.
Carl likes his cars, and he always liked American cars. So when he said to me that he was getting a Mustang, I mean, I didn't have a clue what even it looked like, but I wasn't surprised because I just thought, actually, I can see him in it.
When he bought the Mustang, did you know how he was paying for it?
No, no.
In August 2015, Harvey Proctor made a bold move in an attempt to clear his name. Furious about the public insinuation of guilt, he held a press conference where he described in detail all of Beech's incredible allegations and asserted his innocence.
I denied all and each of the allegations in turn and in detail, and categorised them as false and untrue, and in whole a heinous calumny. They amount to just about the worst allegations anyone can make against another person, including, as they do, multiple murder of children, their torture, grievous bodily harm, rape, and sexual child abuse. I am completely innocent of all these allegations. I am a homosexual. I am not a murderer. I'm not a paedophile or pederast.
A month later, doubts about the story began to emerge in the press. And the BBC's Panorama programme ran an exposé that shed significant doubt on Nick's claims.
There may be a danger. The police are now spending an undue amount of time investigating cases that have all the hallmarks of being fantasy.
I've never experienced pain like it. I hope I never do again. They had no fear at all of being caught.
As soon as I saw the silhouetted head, I knew immediately it was Carl.
Had Carl ever mentioned to you that he had been sexually abused by a group of prominent people?
No.
Did you think any of it could be true, Dawn?
No. I thought, what? 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 Really? 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 Come on. You just think, what the actual fuck is that about? I remember dropping our son off one day and Carl came to the door and he was tearful. And I sort of said to him, oh God, are you okay? And he sort of said, well, I am Nick. I had to be a little bit of an actress and say, oh my God, really?
What were you thinking, Dawn?
No shit, Sherlock.
I was called in nearing the end of the inquiry, at the end of 2015, round about the November time.
What were your findings in this case?
That I thought that there was a big question mark over the reliability of his memory. I had serious doubts about the reliability of his memory.
And what was the police response to your serious doubts?
Well, they thought it was food for thought.
They didn't check his computers. They didn't seek his full medical records at the time. They didn't even ask to see his injuries. They didn't ask for his mobile phone. These were all matters that would have brought this investigation to a crashing halt within hours.
Astonishingly, the Met still hadn't even spoken to Beech's ex-wife. But in January 2016, 15 months into a £2 million police investigation, they finally began to challenge Beech, questioning him about the uncannily accurate drawings he claimed to have made from memory.
There is an incredible amount of similar detail contained within certain drawings and sketches from a recollection of approximately 30 to 40 years ago in comparison to images which are freely out there on the internet to be looked at. Do you understand?
Mm-hmm.
Did you draw these places solely from your memory?
Yeah.
Do you understand why that question has arisen? Can you see why it's arisen?
Yeah.
Sorry?
Yeah.
Beech started to get some criticism. People started saying, is this guy a fantasist? And at that point, he found that discomforting. So then he would call me and he would reveal his newfound reticence. He then started to ask me about withdrawing as a police witness. And that's when obviously I got very suspicious. You know, why would you want to do that at this stage?
In March 2016, the Metropolitan Police finally closed down Operation Midland, having identified no murder victims and made no arrests. By now, Ixaro were facing criticism, having peddled Beech's allegations for nearly 2 years without ever finding convincing evidence they were true.
Did you still believe Carl Beech at that point?
No, I would say that there was a very big change in the way that we perceived it inside Ixaro generally at that point, because so much had been hung on the police's use of the term true that when the police investigation closed without any action being taken, that made it impossible for us to think that the police still believed the allegations. So there was clearly a very big change of approach at that point.
Some people have probably assumed that Beech took you for a fool and that you believed what he said, hook, line and sinker. Did you?
No. We're not talking about a guy who was easy to disprove here. If that had been the case, we'd have got to that much, much sooner. The police would have got to that much sooner.
Is that poor policing? Is it stupidity? What is it?
It was extremely poor policing. Unjustifiable frankly incompetent. There was a post-Saville overreaction and a determination to bring prominent people to justice for sexual misconduct. About that there can be no doubt whatsoever.
They wanted this to be true. This was like the holy grail of abuse, wasn't it? And I think they were seduced by this and they lost all sort of sight of sort of rational thought.
Following a report by Sir Richard Henriquez into the Met's disastrous investigation, Northumbria police were tasked with investigating Beech himself.
December 2016, I had 4 missed calls on my mobile and 2 messages. And it was from a social worker asking me to ring the school as there was a safeguarding issue with my son. And that's when the social worker told me that Carl was a potential risk to children and couldn't be with anyone under the age of 18, which totally blew me away because I thought, hang on a minute, he's been living with our son, He's a children's nurse. Why are you saying this now?
The police raided his house in Gloucester and seized electronic devices. They went through them, analysed them, and found that some of them contained indecent images of children. Indeed, he'd been filming covertly schoolboys. And analysis of these images later found that there was 28 of the worst category, the very most serious categories of abuse. Another 100 of category B and nearly 200 category C images, so quite a collection.
I mean, they kept saying to me, our son is fine, he hasn't, you know, nothing has happened. But how do you deal with that? How do you deal with that? There is no words that you can actually describe how you feel when you hear that about somebody who you were married to for 18 years, that you shared a bed with, and they've got that on their computer. Everything about it, I mean, even thinking about it now makes me just, oh, I don't like to think about it. I don't want to think about it.
I was genuinely gobsmacked by the revelation that he was himself had paedophilic interest, had unhealthy interest in young children. Nothing within my interaction with Beech had indicated that that was the case. And when that bombshell dropped, I was genuinely shocked.
In July 2018, Beech was due in court to face charges of possessing indecent images, but failed to appear.
This is the house Carl bought and the house he renovated.
Whose antlers are they?
It is an elk.
An elk?
Elk. With the horn. Antlers.
In an unexpected turn of events, Beech had fled to Swedish Lapland, where he'd bought a house near the Arctic Circle and was living off his NHS pension.
Did he say why he had come here?
It's cheap to buy houses and it's a beautiful place to stay.
It's quite cold.
Yes, but he said I liked the cold. I remember that. No problem, he said. I like the cold.
Did he speak Swedish?
Yes, some. He speaks some Swedish. My intuition said he was a good man, honest man who wanted to do his best, and he was grateful, a friendly man. A man you can trust.
Did he talk about his life in England?
No, never.
Did he mention that he had a child?
No, never.
So there was never any indication that he had come here to escape justice?
No.
In In October 2018, Beech was extradited from Sweden and brought back to the UK to face trial for perverting the course of justice, fraud, and the paedophile offences.
Accused of being a liar, the man who claimed several high-profile figures were paedophiles goes on trial.
The prosecution dissected all the many lies Beech had told. It turned out there was no sign of any injuries on his body. He'd also lied about being taken out of school by the group.
He claimed to have been able to walk out of school any number of times, and yet there was no equivalent record of absenteeism.
He claimed to have an aversion to poppies in that they'd been pinned to his naked body during abuse parties by military people at Remembrance Day.
But when we were student nurses back in the end of the 80s, we used to wear them on our uniforms, buy a poppy and tuck them in behind your name badge to hold them on. Never having an issue.
He used a Proton email account, that's a Swiss-based email account which is anonymous. He set up that account for someone he called Fred, who was known as Fred to the police. And it was Northumbria Police whose investigations eventually proved that that email account in Fred's name was, lo and behold, Carl Beech. Carl Beech claimed that Ted Heath had taken him on board his yacht, taken him into a cabin, on a double bed, and been sexually abused. Police spoke to yachtsmen who'd worked with Sir Ted Heath and found that racing yachts don't have cabins, don't have double beds, they have hammocks. That's demonstrably untrue what he claimed.
Beech's lies were laid bare most clearly by the computer evidence.
It can take you 2 minutes to find those images of Imber on the internet. We know now Carl Beech was doing that. And not only that, he'd also been back to Imber on one of the visits that you can have every year. So it wasn't that he was recalling memory from the distant past with brilliant accuracy. It was just that he was good at using Google and got on a trip to Imber.
It turned out Beech had been researching his hoax from the very beginning, even before he made his compensation claim and reported his abuse to Wiltshire Police.
The police were able to prove that Carl Beech had looked at an Evening Standard article detailing how victims of Jimmy Savile could claim compensation. One of the things he needed was a crime reference number, so to do that he obviously had to contact the police, and that's what he did. He contacted Wiltshire Police to make his allegations.
Now, a fantasist who made false allegations of murder and child sex abuse against several high-profile figures has been jailed for 18 years. The judge said Carl Beech was a manipulative and devious person who'd fabricated a VIP paedophile ring, accusing people with the highest integrity of vile acts.
Ultimately, Beech turned out to be a complete malicious hoaxer and incredibly dangerous.
They should have given him longer, actually, for the grief he's caused.
I can't fathom why anyone would do that in particular to a group of random people. I mean, it is beyond my comprehension, to be honest.
I think possibly the incentive would be financial.
I don't buy that he was motivated entirely by the money, because £22,000 might seem like a lot of money to some people, and it is a fair chunk of cash. But he's a middle-class guy, he had a decent job. It's probably about half his salary annually. In those terms, when you weigh it up against what he did and what he's been prosecuted for, the financial motivation doesn't really make much sense. £22,000 to ruin your life as well as the lives of so many other people, to serve 18 years in prison, an 18-year sentence, doesn't seem to be something that would tempt you into doing it.
Possibly the attention he was enjoying. I mean, if you're suddenly surrounded by press that are interested in your story, police that are also interested in your story, I suppose it's that 5 minutes of fame.
I think the backlash now against Carl Beech is to dismiss anything and everything that he said and to assume that actually he was a liar, pathological liar, right from the word go. I was asked to look into this and the fairly lurid accusations that he was making. I think it's possible that something did happen in the distant past, in his childhood.
I still think that what he said about Ray is true. I don't understand that if that isn't true, why he would make something like that up. I have to believe that. He told me such a long time ago, why would I not believe what happens with Ray really did happen?
As tempting as it may be to speculate that Beech's story must contain a kernel of truth, it seems that even Beech's allegation that his stepfather Raymond Beech abused him was also, in fact, a lie.
Before he went to Wiltshire Police, he made sure that his stepfather was dead. In fact, he got a private investigator to check up on that, so he was free to make whatever allegations he wanted about his stepfather without his stepfather being interviewed by the police.
I feel sure that these allegations against him would never, ever, ever have happened. Never. It's alien to his nature. He was too honest, too above board. No, it would never have happened.
Explain to me why you're not showing your face, Heather.
I don't particularly want myself and my children associated with this anymore. It's been such a horrendous time for all of us. And even though it's been proven that all of what he said is completely fabricated, it's the sort of mud sticks thing. You worry that there are still people out there who are saying, where did this come from? Something must have happened. Whereas we are adamant that absolutely nothing ever did. And it's so hard when you see that the public figures have been given official apologies and they're now getting that sort of level of sympathy. And yet we're still very much the family of somebody who was accused. It almost feels as though that name hasn't yet been cleared.
Do you believe that Carl Beech was abused by his stepfather?
I most certainly do not. The only evidence that he was abused by his stepfather comes from Nick. There is simply no evidence. It's as simple as that.
It all comes down to evidence, and it has to come down to evidence. That is what this country's criminal system is based on. Does the evidence seem credible beyond reasonable doubt? And in the Carl Beech case, it clearly didn't. And that is not just a tragedy, it is a scandal and has affected and ruined a significant number of people's lives.
I think if I'd not had a very good set of friends and supporters, you do begin to wonder whether you wouldn't, you know, have a nervous breakdown or be really quite ill as a result of the stress.
What saddens me is a man who's had such a distinguished career. The last 4 years of his life were really all about Operation Midland, you know, a time that should have been for sort of quiet reflection on a life, you know, well lived. Became a nightmare, really. And I can't really forgive the Met for that.
I think Carl has got to realise that what he's put me through, what he's put his mother through, and what he's put our son through. That it's his mum and his son, you know, that are the really the people that have been seriously damaged by this.
Has his betrayal been traumatic for you?
Yeah, without a doubt. I had someone who I felt really represented or wanted to represent people who've had no chance in life. And what he'd done, he'd driven a wagon through that, you know, and smashed a lot, really. Total destruction. Total.
He has set back the cause by a considerable amount. Not only are people now probably more wary to come forward, there's now a suspicion that anybody who brings an accusation of childhood sexual abuse is making it up, like Beech did. And that's a whole area of damage that will last for many years to come.
The men enjoyed what they did with always a grin. They hurt me in ways you just can't imagine.
The counselling has been intense and gone really fast, dealing with the nightmare and reliving the past.
Some powerful men were at the heart of the group. They are now being tackled, so at last there's hope.
I know some of them will get away, but despite it all, I've survived here to stay.
Was this in his blogs?
Yes. Even one verse. Would you even do me one verse?
Ah, God. I couldn't read that.